My name is Andrew McKinley. I'm an architect, own a business here in downtown Norfolk, and I'm accompanied by a really great team that's right here at the onset of your project for an enhanced Norfolk Fitness Wellness Center. So to my left, Vice Mayor Martin Thomas, Director of Parks and Recreation, Daryl Crittenden, and Director of Library, Sonal Rasogi. I've got some other members of my team here as well. My business partner, Keith Oliver, and Branding Director, Marshall Dreiling. And then we're also accompanied by Kelly Webb, founder, CEO of KBD Group, who's handled all of our communications and outreach. So just a brief overview of the project. This building that we're all in right now was originally constructed in 1969. It was purchased by the city in 2004. It served the community very well over time, but as many, if not all of us know, there are certain issues with the building that have caused portions of it to be unsafe or unfit for use. And so that's part of the reason for the onset of this project. Some of the knowns for the project, again, this is kind of the first step in the process and reaching out to the public, trying to get a clear understanding of what their priorities are for the future uses here on the site. We set really only very few parameters to get this project started. One is confirmation that we are going to reuse the existing site. And two, that it will be an enhanced fitness and wellness center that will also include a library component. Aside from that, there were no givens, and so that's why we started with the survey that hopefully many, if not all of you, participated in. Just out of curiosity, show of hands, how many were able to take the survey previously? Nice. Okay, that's awesome. So the objective of the meeting here is to review the results and then have a little bit of sharing of what we anticipate the next steps of this process will be. All right, so overall we had just under 800 total respondents, which is really pretty phenomenal. It's a great turnout. Most of those were through the digital means, through the open town hall format. And then we had about 100 that we had hard copies. Those are available at local libraries, local recreation centers. So thank you for filling those out in both ways. We did take the physical copies that we received the hard copies for, and we input that data into open town hall once the survey closed. And so the results that we're presenting here this evening actually capture both the digital responses as well as the hard responses that have been input. So everything that we have received is in this data. So by the numbers and those who participated, just a showing of kind of the age groups, not really too surprising, but of note here is that the younger age groups are a little bit underrepresented by proportion, but you know, what we are here to talk about is just the facts of the survey, and so it is what it is. Also, ladies, thank you for your participation. I could easily make a joke about my household, but this looks proportionally correct. So, again, it is what it is. So we really broke down our survey into four simple categories. We wanted to focus on indoor fitness and wellness, outdoor activities, preferences for libraries, and then because it's going to be a combined facility, what are the preferences for what we just call shared spaces or opportunities where a space could serve one or the other in terms of a building type. So I'll probably just give everybody a minute here to read through this. Is this visible to everybody in the back, or do you want me to stand up and share with you kind of what the high points are? So what you can see pretty clear cut, there's some favorites, for lack of a better term here. But the highest ones were aerobics, fitness, and gymnastics space. So the way that each one of these graphs breaks down, we picked if you were going to use it more than a few times a month, we gave it a would use category. And if you said less than once a month or never, it was weighted to the right in this gray, would never use. So what you can see is that 77% of respondents said that they would use aerobics, fitness, and gymnastics space in the new facility at least a couple of times a month. Cardiovascular equipment area, lap lanes for swim lessons, weight room, this is hydraulic and machine weights. We also have free weights as a separate item. An indoor running and walking track, lanes for recreational swimming, and aquatic areas for therapeutic purposes. So you can see about here, there's a pretty quick drop off. It doesn't necessarily mean anything other than what the statistics of the responses were. But you can see some others that did still rank highly, but not as high. Splash pad, water playground, sport courts for handball, racquetball, squash, multi-purpose courts for basketball, volleyball, pickleball, and then youth exercise areas. Likely. Which is why we wanted to share the age information with everybody. So, outdoor activities. So each of our four categories, we just broke down. We put the highest priority ones at the top of the list. And as you see, each one of these graphs has a very similar trajectory in terms of how it lays out. But you can see the outdoor pool is actually, everybody says they're going to use the outdoor pool, but not quite everybody, but 84%, which was the highest response out of all the responses that we got. Walking track and trail, also very high on the list. And then fitness equipment, exercise area, and obstacle course, you know, still almost 80%, which are phenomenal feedback rate. Others that were interesting, nature explorium, 63%, a community garden space, multi-use courts, outdoors, rentable picnic space, playground, outdoor splash pad, water playground, and outdoor pickleball. Please.
The only thing that this did not survey that I thought was really important is the outdoor space for the soccer, the lacrosse, the football that kind of goes on out here on a, you know, daily basis. And that none of that was in the survey.
That's a great comment. Did you add it to your questionnaire?
Yes.
Awesome. The other one that I've heard mentioned that did not necessarily show up on the survey was green space,
Open
green space. Mm-hmm. And so hearing that, those are definitely things that we're going to add while we're logging back in here. There were some other things that we did get out of the written responses in the surveys that were pretty interesting, and a lot of them were kind of more programmatic of spaces, but a lot more activities like dance, Tai Chi, other class opportunities, and those were more geared towards indoors, but I have heard that about the outdoors, so I appreciate you sharing it. All right, we're back on track. Thank you. Libraries, hands down, the most requested feature or activity in the library is checking out books and print material. That is certainly what I think of when I use a library, but there are plenty of other opportunities for programs and activity uses. So reading space and quiet space, and then studying collaborative rooms. I have heard that there is a lot of demand for this in some of the other facilities around town. Didn't necessarily rank super high in this survey, but neither here nor there. And then some other things that we know are incorporated in many of the newer libraries around town, like the school age zone, after school programs, kids zone, playscape, and teen lounge areas. So many of these are kind of more youth-driven programs. Please.
The one thing that didn't make it, or maybe wasn't asked for, computers.
It's a shared space.
It's in the shared spaces? Okay. Did you add it also to your questionnaire?
I did under libraries.
Okay, great.
The shared space is here.
Well, it was in the original survey under shared space, but that's okay if you want to add it there, please
right,
go ahead.
But would the computer space not be in the library?
It could be handled under either one, but the thinking is that if you have activities going on in one side of a building versus another side of the building, having access to the computers might work itself out to be able to be accessed by either. So if a parent's working out, they've got a younger child that can be doing their homework or something like that, there might be an opportunity to use it as a shared space. Because a building could be closed or open in different portions at different times for different events.
Sort of begs the question, will there be fees to participate in any or all of these activities?
I can only speak on the recreation side. Our fees, basically, a lot of our instructional classes will be rolled up into membership classes, but if there are other classes, yes, there'll be separate fees. and that comes with direct costs for instructors, materials, and supplies.
And Bobby, for libraries, that would not be the case. So free access is still the model that will continue.
And so we'll assume that shared space that might have computers would also be free? Because we would want the computers to be free.
Part
of
the library.
So we can get to them from, like the library is.
Even at our rec centers, we don't charge for computer use.
Okay.
Because it doesn't mean that this shared space would be open at the same hours or times or days.
Right.
What about the tenants? Will they be staying, Prime Plus and the college thing?
Access is not here.
What?
Access is not here.
Because we do taxes with Prime Plus.
Yeah, Prime Plus is certainly a very important tenant in this building, but it's also a very important service to have in the city of Norfolk. So it really is hard to imagine a Norfolk Fitness and Wellness Center 2.0 without them being here. And if it comes to some, and I know Bob Batcher is here somewhere, I saw him. Yeah, I mean, Bob's very much plugged into this entire process. We've talked extensively. If for some reason he's not here, he will be somewhere close by. But I imagine, and I say Bob, but it's Prime Plus. They will be here.
I'll continue on.
The daycare,
yes.
Is that still here? Is that going to be
ADS.
Here? ADS. Adult services.
Oh, I don't know. Is that
going to
be here?
That's all a part of Bob's operations, my understanding.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's a major part.
And Bob, if you want to, please, if you want to fill anyone in, that's fine. Yeah, let us know what you do and what is under your umbrella. That'd be great.
Yeah, we're a major part of the shared space here. So we use a lot of the classrooms, the exercise rooms and that, for 50 and above. So we're an independent nonprofit that's fee-based, but we work in partnership with the city, and it's really been helpful since it's been priced as a rec center, because since the 65 and above is free, we encourage dual membership for a more holistic approach to health and fitness. And then we have an adult day program, which is 45 and above for people who can't be left alone. And the idea for that is to encourage people to be able to stay home with their families instead of going into an institution. That's been extremely successful since we've been in this building. And prior to being in this building, we were on 21st Street with the same kind of arrangement with the city. So it's been, thank you for your endorsement for being a vital part of the community. Especially in today's world, coming off of COVID, we've been averaging about 145 people a morning, Monday through Thursday here, that are doing exercise classes, but more importantly, being in community. And I can't tell you what it's meant to see the smiling eyes of people who have been isolated for 2 years, coming back and being a safe, respectful, inclusive community. And that's really what our purpose is all about. And a lot of that was learned from working with our Parks and Rec program and with the library. So I really see this as a great partnership. We also have a wood shop, a ceramic shop. And when you go down this hall, you'll see a programmed garden that's a meandering garden for our adult day and for seniors. So we really have that kind of footprint, but I think the quality of the center. And then, of course, January through December, we process over 1,000 tax returns. I just got mine today, and I'm not happy. But I'll be available for any questions you might have. And also, after the meeting, if you want to see our facilities, I can show you.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Why didn't the survey specifically indicate Prime Plus or senior services?
They're a tenant. We don't control them, so we don't control what services they offer. So this is just the city portion of the building, what we want your input on.
This next slide here that I'll show you all references both computers and senior services, and I'll show you what the responses were on that. And again, these are just simply the facts and the numbers that came back from the survey. Hopefully we can keep this from doing it again. I'll have to click and keep it active. The highest ones in the shared spaces were the public art gallery, an art studio, both kind of paired up pretty cleanly. Senior services shows itself here.
opportunity for a maker space. We did ask about the potential for a large meeting room. It really got low results. Our thinking is that it's not very frequent that you have a meeting of this size, or 75 to 100 people. That's a pretty big gathering that you don't have that often. So we thought it probably showed a little bit lower for that obvious reason. Game rooms, here's where the computer lab showed up at 30% being used, you know, a couple times a month or more. Commercial demonstrational kitchen. I think it's important to notice that if we need certain features for a building to help to serve certain portions of the community, those things might still be here. And so if a commercial kitchen is needed for senior services and things of that sort, it would still be a critical component for a building. So e-gaming lounge space, auditorium of a larger size, and then youth counseling services even lower.
Excuse me. Yes. Another part of the real estate around here is the In Motion.
We look forward to Bonds and Coors making a big donation to help us build this new building.
No, real quickly,
yes.
Before we move on, what percentage of this total area does shared spaces occupy? More than
20-30%? Today?
Yeah.
I couldn't tell you.
It's right around 34%.
34%,
okay.
Thanks, Daryl.
Yeah.
All right, so as a matter of just kind of seeing all four of these grouped together, and this is just relative, so that you can see, you know, some of these ones that rank really, really high, which is great, and then some that kind of were on the lower end of each category and kind of where they are. Each one of these is kind of a zoomed out version of what you just saw in those four categories.
Can I go back? When we talked about the swimming, have you all thought about approaching the school board? I taught at Grammy for years, involved with the swim team. They don't have a pool. Booker T doesn't have a pool either. This pool right here, the school system, NPS, whatever you call it, could share with the cost of rehabbing this pool and then share with the use during swim season for the swim team. They'd have a home pool to have for meets. And you're only talking 2.5 months a year with swim.
So I'll actually answer that question, because I addressed that with the school board reps for this area. And was told that they personally filled out the survey, but that the school board was not engaging in the process with Parks and Rec and the libraries at this time.
I couldn't quite hear all of that.
The school board is aware of all this, and they have chosen not to participate with Parks and Rec and with the libraries, is what they told me. They are personally involved, but as a school board, they are not taking an active role in this process.
I guess swimming doesn't rank up there with football.
Let me say, it's not just swimming or athletics, it's also after school care and other programs and things. And they do use Parks and Rec for these things today. Right. That's why I reached out and said, I think it would be great for them to participate in the process as another department who's a stakeholder in it. Like I said, they have at this time, as far as I know, still chosen not to take an active role in it.
Can we go beyond this? I mean, it is the city, they're the Norfolk, and this is Norfolk. Is there going up the pyramid, is there someone that can say, school board, you got to talk to Parks and Rec about this? I should ask you, not him.
Well, sir, let me help you out. Right now, NPS, Norfolk Public Schools, they use the Southside Aquatic Center for their swim meets. They also use the Huntersville swimming pool as well. That's an indoor pool. The biggest problem you're going to have, and if you look at these survey numbers, what we're basically seeing, you're going to see lap swimming, you're going to see therapeutic aquatics. The water temperatures differ from a competitive pool than a therapeutic pool. There's no way that you can have an elite swimmer swimming in 85 degree water. You can't have a senior who may have hips replaced swimming in 72 degree water. So when you talk about competitive pool versus therapeutics, it's apples and oranges. And if you look at the survey results, you're going to see lap swimming and therapeutic recreation pool areas.
Okay, somehow I swim in Orangeville and Southside. There's no pool here that's a competitive pool anyway, so that's a non-issue really for our swimmers. All the pools are hot. They're all hot, and that's the way it goes. You get in the full pool, you swim faster.
All right, so my next steps in the process are to take this list of priorities of activities, developing into a space breakdown in the industry of architecture. We call it a program, but I don't.
That better? I think that was something being lost. My next step in the process will be to develop a space breakdown based on this list of priorities of activities. It's important to note that there are some spaces that could be programmed to accomplish multiple things, which is an efficiency for the use of the building. So what we will look at is what spaces are necessary in order to accomplish the priority items. We will then assign a historical cost value to each one of those space items and present that information to the city manager's office for review. If I don't know how many were involved in the first presentation, it was a virtual presentation, but we haven't defined a budget for the project yet. There's been no budget that's defined by the city. And so what we want to present them is, here's what the priorities are, here's what the cost levels for each one of these things might be, and permit the city really to then go in and decide essentially what can be afforded to accomplish the priorities. Well, I think I just covered a lot of that. So we don't know the project budget. Depending upon the budget and the square foot, will impact the square footage, will impact potentially the number of stories, depending upon things like, you can see this waterway here and the flood prone site and how much green space will be left, how to sequence construction, whether we can reuse the existing building or it's got to be all new or a combination thereof. So there's a lot of decisions still to get made, but we're really still one step beyond the start of the process, thanks to the input from the community, which is phenomenal. Come on. So that concludes the end of my presentation. We've been taking questions all along. We've got a list of people that did sign up who were brave enough to sign up. So I'm gonna have Kelly actually start calling names, and then we will take hands to feel free.
All right, Marty Rain. Let's see. Can you all hear me okay, or do I need to go up front? The old teacher here. Okay. Since a lot has already been said about Prime Plus, I'm not gonna bore you too much. I'm the president of the board of Prime Plus here, and Bob is amazing, and he keeps contact with you guys, which is great. How many folks here are in any way affiliated with, aligned with, use Prime Plus, or members of the board of Prime Plus, whatever? Would you guys stand up? Or use it, yeah. So you can see we didn't go about trying to bring folks here. They came on their own. You can see that there's a really large constituency that uses the Prime Plus facilities and programming. Our purpose, our mission, is to encourage and support seniors in the Hampton Roads area in their pursuit of social, emotional, physical, financial, and intellectual wellness. We are hoping that with Bob at the table as you're planning, we will have some real dedicated space for the kind of programming that we are doing and doing incredibly successfully. And you guys that are here and interested and care, thank you. We want to keep serving you in the way that we've been doing and even better. Thank you.
That's not fair. She did a better job than I did at talking about Prime Plus. Thank you.
I might butcher this name, so sorry. Is it Rhoda Bellans?
Yes, thank you. My question has to do with the libraries. I'm an avid library user, and I was wondering if you have any concept of how much space would be allotted for the library use you're not going to have the computer space, is my understanding. That'll be part of the multi-space. Is that correct?
I don't know that we, do you want to answer? I don't know that we know that yet. I mean, so we don't know where things are going to be located yet, because what's going to happen now is based on all the information that we now have, the experts are going to try to lay it out for us on a building and say, okay, well, we can share in efficiencies by putting shared spaces in this portion of the building and directly library-directed stuff in another portion and recreation in the other portion, and hopefully it all fits very well so that it's not entirely separate. But we really don't know what the space is going to be for each one yet.
Yeah, I think, and just to help the vice mayor some, is that your programs, your priorities will drive the scope of the building and the size of the building. So what Andy and his team are going to do is they're going to look at the priorities, and based on the priorities, that will drive the size of the facility. So it's too early at this point in time to actually give you specifics on size or the overall square footage of a facility, because they got to take all the programs, all the priorities, and then try to come up with a concept. Then you'll start seeing basically what type of size and what type of square footage for each designated program you'll have. But we're way too early in the game right now.
And Daryl, to add to your comments here and Vice Mayor's, Rhoda, what we plan on doing is we have already laid out some basic programmatic trends and spatial functions. So we have discussed that, we have put that on the table, and again, we wanted to have the community input based on the priorities and those programmatic needs. We will then design the spaces accordingly.
Mark Jones?
My question is answered.
Thank you. It's me, I guess. I'm sorry. That's okay, first name is Christina. I want to advocate for the lower age group. I mean, when I filled out the survey, I filled it out for my son, who's a 10th grader at Granby. So, and I'm going to have a grandchild in the summer, so I need to come back to have a good playground. So, I just want to make sure that only because they didn't answer the survey in higher numbers as us women obviously did, that they will still be like cared for, and that we have outdoor sports areas for them, indoor sports areas, because I mean, when I used to come to the fitness center until 2 years ago, there was always basketball going on in the afternoon, so I would like that to keep on happening. And then my pet little thing is we are going to have a bike lane on Granby Street, and we have so many people in Norfolk that cannot ride bikes properly. So can we do something for bike paths for young kids to learn the rules and regulations, like stop signs, things like that? I think that would be a nice thing.
I think basically because we're a landlocked city, green space is at a premium. So no matter what type of parks and rec amenity we have, we take that in consideration. We always want to preserve some green space. So I think when Andy and his team lay out everything, they will take in consideration, and actually it was part of our survey, making sure we preserve some green space for open recreation. So they'll do their best to make sure that's completed.
Hi, I'm Jean Swartz, president of the Friends of the Norfolk Public Library. So I come tonight to try and support the efforts to put a library in this space as well, and to provide input from people that I meet in the community to make sure that the library serves the needs of our city, but also not at the cost of some of the nearby neighborhood branches. And that's, you knew that I asked the question about computers, because that's always a significant part of the library, and that they be open and available, because right now our libraries close at 6 p.m. So the students that are in the back, if they needed access to a computer right now, they could not get one in the city of Norfolk. So it may be because the library will be part of the rec center, or it'll automatically have better hours, which would be a lovely marriage. Yeah, well, and the library will be the free part with the shared space. And there's a beautiful marriage that can happen here with all the discussion of senior services, and then the opportunity to bring the books and learning into that marriage, along with we're always looking at the kids in the libraries and what to do with them, and then with the teens. an opportunity for book club and discussion. So I think it's a beautiful thing to happen. I just want to make sure that libraries get kind of the right space here, and then again, that we don't compromise the other ones like Larchmont and Lafayette and Pretlow that are close by too, because it's a, you know, we all know there's a finite set of money. So if we keep adding new ones, and then we, you know, it's going to be hard to keep adding them at the level we want. So thank you.
Jean, I wanted to say something. Parks and Rec and Library has been married for about 20 years. But no, but seriously, I do want to say this. We're coming through a pandemic. Sona and I both are still actually operating under abbreviated hours. As times get better, we get through this pandemic, money starts flowing back in, our hours will enhance. So I think what you see now with libraries is because right now they're operating based on what their budget constraints are, but those things are starting to open up, and I'm sure libraries will be opened a lot longer, either if it's on our side or if it's on Sonal's side.
So thank you, Daryl, but and thank you, Jean, for your beautiful comments. But what I am really excited about with the shared space and the organic natural opportunity is the intergenerational programming. So with our wonderful seniors and teens and even school-age children, I think there's such an opportunity, a plethora of opportunities. So that's what I'm excited about in this particular space.
Is it Lois Gabriel?
Yeah, here. Answering that gentleman's question over there, my question already got answered. The city does need a competitive pool on this side of the city. They don't have one, and I don't know how long they're going to wait for Maury to get rebuilt, and they may have one there or not, but the city does need a competitive pool. My answer is, the question was already answered. Thank you.
Brenda Gray?
Mine's been answered.
It's
about the green space.
Thank you. Susan Platt?
Hi, my name is Susan Platt. I have lived in this area since I was a small child, and I've been at what was used to be the JCC growing up, and I lived my life in this field, and I hear everyone talking about all the amenities and library and all that, but I think the people that live around here are passionate about the field. I know I am. I keep telling my husband, it's going to be World War III if they take away our field, so... I don't know how to tell you how important that field is.
It's interesting.
No, we brought our children there. I was here as a child. I brought my children. We bring our grandchildren, even if it's just to go learn how to throw the frisbee or play bat baseball, all the things that you teach your children how to do. It's just it's so important, and the teams that are playing there. But just the green space to just go walk your dog, just to have that air and space. Yeah. I'm passionate about it. Chris, you have something to say?
You did beautiful.
Hey, Susan, I just wanted to say, I know that's a premium, green space. We have not got to the point where we're going to determine if we demolish this building and then put the new one in the green space there and then make the old site where the old building is green space. We have 11 acres to work with. We recognize that green space is a premium, so we do know whether we flip sides, we have to have green space.
And it's not just that, if the new space is near where we live, like right there at the edge of the field, we already deal with so much traffic on North Shore and all of our side streets.
Yeah.
And it just feels like it's going to be worse. And if there's an entrance there off North Shore that goes right into a building where, you know, the library and the rec center is, it's going to even be worse for us.
And I'd like to add what Susan's saying is that where the space sits now, it's back. It's not in your face. It's not in everybody's property's face that sits over here. And I think that's just a big part of our community that you come in. It's beautiful green space. This sits back here. And yes, I know there are limitations with the waterway over here, but that's, I think, the important feature and the beauty of why this rec center works well here. And I personally don't want to be the rec center of Norfolk because the traffic problem is going to be an issue. It's already an issue.
With children and dogs,
yes,
and cats.
And people speed
and
all the time. And it's already a huge traffic situation.
Yeah,
and it's a cutthroat.
I raised my children saying, caution, danger.
Yeah.
You know, they have problems when they were young being out inside.
Yeah, the only way I can sum that up, Susan, is we have a great architectural firm, great IDQ contractor, and no, it's good you're bringing this up because Andy and his team are writing this down because when they go into conceptual design phase, these are some of the things they need to consider. So no, it's good that you're telling us this.
Traffic be involved in all of this?
Yes. As part of site plan review and design review, engineering department, stormwater, that's gonna be huge. All the city departments will be involved.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I can see if this is a major rec center on a main thoroughfare already, but we're not. We're in the community, and that makes a big impact for additional traffic that's coming into our space.
Brendan and I have a hard time even crossing Newport.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's already
You can
busy.
Get hit easily.
I don't have too much time. Uh-huh.
That's me.
I'm on. You're good?
No, I already have it on.
Bill Church?
Again, my name is Bill Church, and I've just... I went to the Norfolk Library, just picked up a book. I think one of the items that they have in this book is emergency use. So when you go into the design phase, are you going to look at this building as a possible emergency use for, this happens to be talking about quarantine, but for hurricanes and things of that nature? It may not be a great site since you have the river coming right up behind the building, but it's easier to put it in as you build it than it is to retrofit. And they also talked to a Corps of Engineers reference in here, so get the Corps of Engineers downtown. Might be a good source of information to get you off the ground floor if you haven't examined that already.
And Bill, I forgot to mention, we have our city architect here too, John Alford, who does a great job too, so all the city concerns, he's listening as well. So we're getting it from both sides. We're getting it from our...
It's a great book.
Gerlinger, yeah, that's me. So I'm gonna say one technical thing first, and that's why when I took the survey, and I think there's others that may have interpreted it this way, but when I saw lap swimming, exercise swimming, I put that in parallel with like competitive type swimming. And I think the people with children and even adults who do competitive swimming probably read that line and thought, that's the line I need to check. So if we're saying competitive swimming is not part of that, I think we've got to recapture that,
yeah, that
input somehow. I think there's a large number of people that saw that line and that's the box they checked. But the thing I really want to say is that the survey, everything in the survey was focused on features and amenities of this future building. And I really think, you know, I do some design work with my day job, it's software, it's not buildings like this, but I mean, we try to focus on outcomes, and like, I think what we're trying to seek with this facility is a measurable change in resident wellness, and like that's physical, mental, emotional, educational, and in order to do that, I think we've got to keep a focus probably first on like programs and services, and second on amenities that support those programs and services, because like I don't need a gym that isn't open early enough for working population to come to. I don't need a pool that doesn't have lifeguards. You know, I don't need a dance room that has a class instructor because we don't have one, and or like a library that doesn't have computers for people to use, right? So I don't want to build something where we go, and now you can't use it because the programs and services aren't there to fit fill it, right? So I'd rather scope out the programs and services and build the building to fit that. So I don't know if that's a way to spin that around and do that, but that's really where I think we need to focus. And I think the key with that then too is all those programs and services take a, it takes a place, the building, but it also takes staff. And I think the key is when you're starting to design some of this stuff, I think one of the questions you keep asking yourself is this a desirable place to work? Like, would I want to work there and be inspired to like work there? Because if we can make this a place that staff really wants to be here and do stuff, it's gonna make those services and programs even better.
And that's really how they're paid. Are they paid full-time or part-time? Are they, paid well? I mean, that's important, and I know that, financially it's an issue because there's a budget involved, but I mean, the problem we have now, and I don't know that it'll get any better, is nobody has enough staff to do anything for any place they work, and will that be a continuing trend? So you're gonna build something, if you build it, they'll come, but will they work here?
I can answer that. If anybody had a chance to listen to the city manager's budget proposal last night, he has put in place a lot of incentives to make sure that the workforce that we currently have here stay in place. Average hourly rate of $18 an hour is huge. The other thing is that we're doing too is we're looking at incentives for recruiting people to come to work in the city. I think as time goes on, there won't be a problem. And something the city manager told me is he's trying to get away from part-time seasonal staff, and he wants to hire more full-time staff. One, you can get more out of full-time people. There's buy-in because they have benefits, and they're committed to the city. Not saying part-timers aren't, but there's a far greater commitment. So those are some of the things the city manager's doing. So I think as time goes by, you're going to see not a larger workforce, but you're going to see a workforce that's committed, being well taken care of, and I think they will have fun in a new facility here.
Retention is always an issue with part-time people, or has been. I mean, we had several positions in libraries pre-pandemic, and we rarely had about maybe 50% filled all the time, so.
Mm-hmm. Lee Paul?
Hi, a couple of things that weren't mentioned at all, and I'm not sure if the lunchroom serving the seniors is included in Prime Plus. I want to make sure that that's like on the list. Another thing, somebody mentioned that reading the survey was a little difficult. When I read the survey, I'm here, well, and until I had this accident with the foot, but I was here 4 days a week, ate lunch every day, and a lot of my, seniors are like that. But when I filled out that survey, I would have had to put down, no or less than once a month. It was not geared at all toward, will you use the gym, will you use the pool, will you do this, will you do that? Well, no, I come to Prime Plus. I'm a senior, I'm 78, I can't do all that stuff that you asked about. So you're building this whole concept on the priorities. X number percent want to do this and X number percent want to do that. Well, all the seniors at Prime Plus can't do all that. But it doesn't sound like, according to the survey, that we're very actively involved. And I think that I can speak for most of the seniors that I know that we're probably more involved in Prime Plus and here more often than the people that use the other side. And it's debatable, I understand that. But you couldn't show that at all on that survey. So when we're doing this exactly just by priorities, I think that's a little...
Yeah.
And, I just want to mention that. Another thing, I'm newly into this being disabled thing, and this building has problems. Are we really going to, make that a triple number one? There's so many things like doors that pull open. You ought to see me trying to get into some of these places. Trying to pull a door, push this, grab this, push that, hold the door, and then, if there's nobody around, then I have to, use the hip that I just got replaced to try to hold the door. It's funny to look at. It's not. Anyway, I'm sure you have the disability. Please, and another thing that wasn't mentioned, this is kind of silly.
bathrooms. Our classes get over, say, at 12 o'clock. Well, out comes 400 people, well, however many people, on all the classes, and you've got 5 minutes to go to the bathroom. There's two that half of us can't get into because they were late for kindergarten. And there's two stalls up in the front. Can we do a little something about adding maybe more of those kind of things?
Yeah, I definitely.
Yeah, I was going to say the survey is one important piece of this process, but this public meeting is another important piece as well. And so the feedback that you're giving about things like Prime Plus is not unheard just because we have the survey results. So I want to start with that. Any new facility is going to be fully accessible. And this facility, when it was constructed in 69, was constructed by whatever requirements were or were not in place at that point in time. And so modern standards require a lot more ability for ease of mobility in and throughout, and particularly in restrooms. So we will definitely accommodate that. Yeah.
Carrie Buchanan?
And I wanted to reiterate some of what's been talked about on the green space side of the house. I live on North Shore, directly across from that field. So I know what that field gives this neighborhood. I can see every day how many people use that field, how many people they've got their dogs, they've got their kids. You've got two or three teams going all at once practicing. That field is well utilized all the time. And it is also a huge, major amount of water collector.
Yeah.
I mean, without it, this neighborhood would flood.
Yeah, it's a microclimate or a macroclimate, too.
It makes cools
everything. A breeze comes right through, it cools all that neighborhood off. It cools those streets down.
We like it there, where it is.
not here.
I don't want to be blocked by a building. And one other thing about North Shore. North Shore is not designed for large through traffic, and it is not designed for a large parking lot to come in off of to serve this facility. Newport is better designed for exactly that, and there's still a lot of complaints about for people who live along that, but it is definitely not. We got some street problems.
Hi, good evening. My name is Marilyn, and I am a resident of Burr Point. Lovely, lovely area. I'm very happy to be here. I'm also the director of the In Motion Physical Therapy next door. I just want to recognize that we had and served over 1,400 new evals last year alone. We were able to keep people out of the hospital due to pain because we shut down surgeries across the Hampton Roads market. So we have really given back to this community because we love it. We love being here and being a part of it. As you know, Boxacor is, the campus itself is being sold, but we still want to be here as part of your physical therapy partnership. We are a nonprofit facility, and we do give a lot back through our charity care. There are members in our community that cannot afford physical therapy or the $65 copay that some insurances have. And so we do give back a lot of free care as well. And so I just want to just reiterate to all of you that we are a good partner for this community, and we want to be here with you. For someone who's 52 on Wednesday, on Saturday, we're all going to have those aches and pains as we age. But we also have our swimmers that we've talked about. We have our concussion programs that we treat our youngsters with. So we see the gamut, and we want to be here and be your partner in the future. Thank you.
And you are a good partner.
Yes, I'll tell you, I have a great story. We were doing some collateral advertising, and we went to Prime Plus, and we had a patient who we were transporting back and forth for physical therapy. But there was a gentleman who was just so gregarious and so dynamic. We made him our supermodel, and so he was in our collaterals, and he was is just so thrilled, and his family was thrilled. So we do have a great partnership with you guys.
Bridget Husky. Yeah, I just have one quick question. This may be premature since we're still over at the very beginning of this whole process, but is there any idea about the timeline and when this might
open its doors.
We are recording.
Yeah, we don't know yet. The reason why is we haven't even started designing process. The main thing we want to do is nail down what the programming components are going to be. That's going to drive cost and actually also drive space. And then once we get the priorities nailed down, then that's when we'll turn it over to Public Works via design and work with our Public Works engineers, our city architect to really hammer this out. And then they'll come up with a construction schedule, hopefully. But right now it's basically about planning, design, knowing what the priorities are.
Did you tell them anxious to get a pool back?
Yeah, I know y'all been waiting a long time.
Joan, and I'm not able to make out the last name. Is it Turpin or Joan?
Oh, that's me. My questions have been answered.
Okay, thank you. Carol, Jackie?
She already headed out.
Okay. Rebecca Benz?
That's me. I just wanted to also advocate for the field. That's why we're here, because it's used heavily by our family. And it's the only field that we can ride our bikes to and get some exercise. So I'm wearing River Point as well.
Kent Freeman?
I have my say, but I just want to add, I learned some from this lady. I should have used the word sharing and marriage between the school board and the Parks and Rec.
Another River Point neighbor. Couple things. I just think as you guys look forward to this, I know you're in the middle of the planning and program stage, but your hours are key to getting more people in this neighborhood to come. I was members of the JCC. I joined this, but your hours really do not allow people coming for work or after work, and that keeps a lot of people away. And then, of course, I am a master gardener. Please save the trees that are on this lot.
Yes.
Yeah, add some more. Len Brock Taylor?
Yes. Hello. I also live in the neighborhood, been here a long time, and I've been a long-time user of the pool, and I was just hoping in your design you could do something to create or keep the kind of ambiance that's in the pool. The domed pool is really quite remarkable. If you swim at night, you can see the stars. If you swim early in the morning, you see the sun. It's really very unique in the city. So to replace it with an indoor dark pool would just be not happy. So in the design of it, there's a real ambiance and vibe here that is very community-centered, kids, open to everything. And to kind of keep that in mind, Gerlinger said, you know, the space, what it's for, and what it's supposed to feel like, rather than just this number of feet, and keeping the trees and having the shade. There's a lot that's here that's not measurable. And just one note on the survey, I too felt the survey was difficult. There wasn't enough space to just, when you said, you want to tell us anything else? It was a long, skinny line.
Yeah.
And you couldn't see what you said before or after. And you had to be really persevering to say something. So there was a structure of the survey that was kind of, they don't really want to know what I have to say.
Yeah.
Right. Kind of a feeling that you got from it. So that's my.
Yeah. And I think too, like what you said with the dome, it was beautiful. And then the fact that they could slide open doors in the
when
it was summer, so you can get the natural air in there. And I think that was a really nice space and feature to that area.
And there's just generations of people who have swum in that pool with children and grandchildren, and they all remember it's not just the pool, it's the dome pool, you know.
I think again with this building being constructed, I think, in the 50s. Materials have changed. There's a lot of new technology. I mean, there are ways to design things now. We can still capture that ambience, but actually have better materials. Yeah. And so that's why we have the architects here, and they're going to be working to actually make sure you get that ambience and still basically have some of the features that you want. And we have better materials now in 2022.
Fantastic,
and if they could
bend
to the picture of what it was,
it would have
been the best of both worlds.
Richard?
That's a tough one.
Yeah, I know. My name is Richard Drummerite, and I've been around a long time. And everybody's a part of a group here, so I decided to create my own group. That's Old Guys for Wellness.
Yeah.
Mr. Crittenden, kudos to your staff.
Thank you, sir.
They know Richard D., Annette, Brandon, and I can go on and on. Nice people. We have a real opportunity, folks, for a gold standard right here. There's not many parcels in Norfolk that have this. Good gosh, let's don't mess it up. One standard we could have. I was thinking coming over here what we could do, and I was imagining things. When you come in to the facility, you see some old people, and I'm not old, I'm young. Can you imagine coming into that facility that's like a community room? You could have big screen TV with what's going on in the fine city of Norfolk. You could have library, you could have space for coffee, and you really address the physical, mental, and emotional needs of our public. There's so much you can do to make a statement. Right now, you come in and there's, yeah, I see the Prime Plus exercise in the chairs, and that's wonderful. But it could be so much more than that, so much more. Can you imagine a grandparent being there, sitting there, reading a nice journal, watching television, ping pong going on, and the kids really bother old folks sometimes. Off to the side in a library setting. So we really have an opportunity. I hope we vet this as well as we did the bike lanes. Congratulations, whether you like bike lanes or don't like them, the city did a good job in vetting it. Please keep that in mind. And thank you for the opportunity to allow me to speak and be a part of this process. Thank you.
Mary Richardson?
Oh, well, no, thanks. I had a few more minutes to gather my thoughts, but I live here in the community, and I just wanted to echo a couple of things that I heard. The first thing is in regards to the doorways and the ADA compliance. I think that is definitely necessary, not just necessarily for someone who's a senior, or someone who's younger, who has any kind of disability. Mm-hmm. I know it is a requirement, so that's something I think you definitely want to make sure we include that. I live on Newport Avenue. The traffic is awful. There's a stop sign where I am, and I look out my window and I constantly see people just riding by. They never stop. They don't even slow down. So at the corner of Newport and right behind Grandview High School, it's a really bad traffic situation. So I think that needs to be taken into consideration for this establishment. In general, it just needs to be looked at because it's definitely an opportunity for something dangerous to happen there. And then the hours of operations, I think, is something that definitely needs to be looked at. For someone who's still working, mm-hmm. you may not be able to participate in programs that are after hours or during the day. And even though we are still working, we still have our need for wellness. I think this is something to consider. Thank you.
Hey, we're going to put a couple people on the spot, mm-hmm. and I'm looking at the youngest people here.
Yes.
You've identified yourselves as field users, but we'd like to hear from you how you use the field. What's your favorite thing to do out there?
I love swimming in the summer and the yoga.
Can I just add one thing that I don't think Ben emphasized that I was thinking when she was talking about in motion? We didn't mention that we have so many yoga programs here that are so necessary. When you have Medicare, which the senior center, you know, we all have Medicare, okay, they only pay, and I really know all about it right now, they only pay for X number of visits to your physical therapist. But guess what? You go to InMotion and you finish up there, and you come over, and we're doing half of the things in our exercise, in our sit-down exercise programs for seniors, that my insurance was paying $300-some an hour, but you know, that's neither here nor there. But we're doing the same things here, and they're keeping me on my foot, which is really necessary. We have balance classes. We have so many things that are keeping our seniors out in the community, that are keeping people like me walking and someplace to go. Because if I couldn't come here, then the only place I could go walking is the grocery store, and that's really hell on my pocketbook. And my waistline with the needles. But I don't think that's mentioned enough. That, you know, and the social aspect, of course, is a biggie, because I can sit home, which I just did for 2 years, as we all did. But if it wasn't for, where can the seniors go? And I ask you to look around at all the other senior centers. There's only one I know of that has any kind of camaraderie, and I think Carrollton's closed now, the senior center when Mr. Young retired. But there's not a senior center that provides what Prime Plus does here, but I think we need to emphasize more the health aspect too, because it really is, after Medicare and your physical therapy stops, there's nothing else in the city that you can do if you can't come here. And I just want to get, we really need to emphasize.
Anyone who hasn't spoken yet? And again, we're going to try and keep these to about a minute.
I assume that as the project takes shape and gets off the ground, you're going to come up with options. Are we going to have follow-on meetings like this where you'll present option A, B, and C as you come up with different modules and how it's going to take shape? Are we going to have more meetings like this where we can see the progress and see options?
Yes. There will definitely be more meetings with more public input. I mean, it'd be very straightforward on that. Yes.
My name's Penny Pickle, and I raised my children at this center. They learned to swim here. They're 21 now and not living at home, thank goodness. And I was concerned, and so I have kind of a question about how the distribution of the survey went, because I was disappointed to see that young families were not represented in this survey. I've taken my money out of the city of Norfolk, and I drive to Virginia Beach to utilize their recreational centers because they have some of the best things to offer. And I didn't see childcare while parents are working out. I didn't see that sift up to the top of the list. And I mean, even recently I was one of the YMCAs, and they have a beautiful childcare center. And I used it when my kids were little. So how was the survey distributed that it was not really representative of all of Norfolk? Is the city of Norfolk really gonna invest this much money in just a facility that's only used by seniors? And if so, then we can keep the hours short, because we are retired and can go during the day when no one else is working. So I'm not making a slam against our current recreational facilities hour offerings, because I know that we're coming out of a 2-year quarantine. So I just, my concerns are about representing a broader range of people that inhabit the city of Norfolk. So, yeah.
I think the sheer number of respondents, that we had 800 respondents that came in and logged in over the course of 4 weeks is a phenomenal response. And we have no control over who reads the media, but there was social media, there was print media, there was plugs on city websites. So if the younger groups did not find it important, that's kind of their endless opportunity.
I simply sent it out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did the high school send it out?
My name is Nate Tennyson. I have lots of kids in swim programs throughout the city. I've been a lifelong user of Norfolk Parks and Rec. I'm on the Parks and Rec Commission. And when you look at this facility that we're sitting in now, we're talking about a 70-year-old building, right? The fact that we're talking about what we need right now is almost statistically irrelevant because we're looking at a building that's going to last another 70 to 100 years. And on top of that, 800 respondents in a city of 245,000 is less than 0.3% of the entire population in Norfolk. So you're talking again about a statistical irrelevance to what Norfolk really needs. So I guess my question
I'm very concerned about that.
My question really is for the baseline architecture and the planning, what standards are we setting as a baseline for the rebuild of an actual rec facility here in Norfolk as a baseline? Like it will have A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, and then the programming and other components are going to be piled on top of that. I think looking and waiting around to see what color the bricks are going to be or what color, you know, the exterior siding is going to be, again, it's irrelevant. What really matters is where are we starting with what we're going to be getting here? And, you know, how far does the money that will be eventually allocated go towards making that vision happen? Because we're talking for the next 100 years here. Lots of programs are going to change.
Daryl, can you talk about what you guys did as a master plan?
Sure. We're in the middle of updating our master plan, the Parks and Recreation Master Plan. We had close to almost near 800 people respond for Parks and Recreation. What was identified in the Parks and Recreation Master Plan update was, number one was bikes and bikeways and trails. Number two was access to water. Number three was larger community centers. And so what we're looking at now is Norfolk may be transitioning in the future. No longer will we have self-contained little small huts as recreation centers, and that goes back to the Virginia Beach comment, because when people actually compare Virginia Beach and Norfolk, we're talking apples and oranges. Our largest center in this city is only 27,000 square feet. And I don't consider this a rec center because this is our fitness center. This is the municipal YMCA. So our largest rec center is only 27,000 square feet. Virginia Beach is 88,000 to 100,000 square feet. So you kind of get the difference. Our centers are one room in a Virginia Beach Recreation Center. So there's only so much you can do as far as programming. And I see my team back there, our assistant director, Ed, Jacqueline, our division head. During the summer, when we have summer camps, the public doesn't have access to our rec centers. The reason why is if you have 100 youth from 8:30 to 5 o'clock in a rec center, who else can get into a rec center that's only 18,000 square feet? So the public doesn't have access until 6 to 8:30. The good thing about what we're doing tonight is that recreation will change. There's a philosophy now by our new city manager. The council's been introduced to it. Is maybe this will be the prototype for a large center that will be somewhere around 65 to 85,000 square feet. Maybe there will be 5 rec centers built in the city, and there won't be any more little small hubs where people can enjoy, and you'll have all components of recreation in it, from arts and crafts, music and dance, boxing, athletics, therapeutic recreation. So everything that we offer in little small centers will now be in these larger centers where everybody can get the best of everything, seniors, everything. So that's sort of the direction that the city is going to be heading to in the future.
The building here is approximately 100,000 square feet. So you're talking about reducing it by half?
I didn't hear you.
I say that the building presently is approximately 100,000 square feet
here.
Yeah. No, I didn't say we'd reduce it. Again,
you stated 65,000 square feet.
That was just an example. Okay. because right now I'm only working with 27,000 square feet.
Daryl, what's the timeline for the master plan to get updated?
Our consultant will be presenting to the city council in May with the final results. Mm-hmm. Yes.
My concern, and I do absolutely agree that there should be child care, especially for people who are working out or something. I would just be concerned about thinking that, well, we can send all those little kids into the library because that's a nice, quiet space. Librarians are not babysitters.
Thank you. Yeah.
Please.
Thank you.
Have a designated area for kids with some sort of supervisor who knows how to handle rambunctious kids.
I'm just saying because, I'm a senior citizen myself, but this has to be a multi-generational building. We have to have programs for all ages.
Yeah.
I'm just going to say that. So that's all we're talking about is for older. I'm a senior citizen, but we have a lot of kids in this neighborhood and in this community that need to have a place to go to have fun.
I want to talk about those of you who said you were shut in during 2 years. Yeah. Mr. Crittenden might explain to you what the Elizabeth River Trail is. It never shuts. I was outside all the time, winter and summer. The Elizabeth River Trail is great, and it's a pretty ride, goes all the way down the waterside. So if you feel shut in, get whatever part of it is, you get out on your bike and get on this river trail. And you get out in the air, and you don't have to worry about transmitting.
We got one more question here.
Even with a bad hip.
So the survey, I heard people mention that it sounds like the survey was focused, the recipients were mostly seniors. Did you ask for that demographic information? Did you not? So I didn't know if you sliced it and diced it where you can show that you received this much with this particular population and that from that particular population. Because I don't see that as a summary. Within the survey. That's it.
We do have those results, and over half of the respondents were over 55. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.